Greetings of the day. I'm Shanuka Jain, Center of Finance, Insurance, Risk, Economics Coordinator. Welcome all of you on the behalf of Modi University. Today we have Dr. Anirban Sen Gupta, Dean of School of Business, Dr. Suren Singh Rajpuri, Associate Professor of School of Business as moderator. And last but not the least, Sudhir Das Ma'am, Vice President of SOTC Traveler as a speaker. Before we begin, I would like to introduce Sudhir Das Ma'am. With the 24 years of extensive experience in travel industry, spanning multiple functions of sales, relationship management, product development, contracting, and purchasing. She played an instrumental role in shaping the MICE business at SOTC. Prior to this, she has done her master's in economics from one of the prestigious colleges known as Gokhale Institute of Politics and Economics, and her MBA from Pune University. The topic of webinar is tourism industry post COVID-19. Now I request Suren sir to start the webinar. Sir, over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shanuka. And good evening, everybody. First of all, on behalf of School of Business, Modi University, I would like to welcome all the participants and of course our speaker of the day, Ms. Suti Das, Vice President, SOTC Travel Limited, who has been kind enough to spare time from her busy schedule to enlighten all of us. Before we start, I would just like to inform all the participants that if any of you want to ask any question, you may raise it in the chat box. And then towards the end of the session, we will request ma'am to address as many questions as possible, depending upon the availability of time. So with this, without wasting much time, let me start with my first question. In the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic, there have been multiple studies and various estimates doing the rounds in media as to how this pandemic is going to impact the world economy in general and Indian economy in particular. But one thing is more or less certain, that one of the most severely impacted sectors is the one which incidentally has also been one of the biggest contributors to GDP of our country, as well as one of the biggest employment generators, the tourism sector. But what we would like to hear from you, ma'am, is that what is your take on the extent and gravity of the overall impact of COVID-19 on tourism sector. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Purohit. Hello, everyone. I hope all of you are hale and hearty, happy and safe at your respective locations. Yeah. Being in the hospitality industry, we only talk about or focus about one C, that is the customer. And of course, from the business perspective, we also look at the other C, which is the cash flow. But by now, 2.5 months, since the last 2.5 months, there have been so many C's which have been revolving around us, right? Coronavirus, COVID-19, cases confirmed, confinement, containment zone. I think we need to leave all these C's aside and focus on what we are good at, taking care of our customers, right? While the impact of COVID-19, we all know, will see a definitive change to the world as we know it. SOTC Travel has chosen to stay motivated and focused and seize every opportunity to make the most of it during this lockdown. Now we are known, SOTC is the pioneer in the travel industry. And at the forefront is our innovation always. So we have actually focused our energies and invested our resources and time in engaging with our internal customers, which are our employees, and our external customers, also with our supply chain. We have done series of webinars for training ourselves in associations and partner with the hotel partners along with the tourism board. And we've come up with more than 1,000 certified destination specialists, which and these, mind you, these are certified by the tourism board. And now with these specialists, they'll help us to cater innovative products. So we always say when there's a crisis, we always come out stronger and better. 2.5 months have actually helped us to rethink, to reimagine, to rebuild, and to redefine our offerings in the light of COVID-19 pandemic. And thus we have elevated ourselves, I would say, to the next level, to the next generation of travel experience. So I think we are all waiting to look forward. How do we now, whatever we have, the time we have invested in this last 2.5 months, we are waiting to implement and actually ensure that the customers are taken care of.
Okay, fair enough. Next question would be, as we all know, that post COVID-19, the social distancing and as well as the enhanced health and safety measures are going to be the new normal. So what challenges do you foresee in it, especially given the kind of food and eating habits we have in India? And how do you think the implementation of these health and safety measures can be and should be implemented or ensured in travel and tourism industry in particular?
Okay. Like I told you, we have engaged ourselves with our customers. So both in the leisure segment, that is the B2C segment, and the B2B segment, that's with the corporates, we have connected with our key corporate clients, and we have also connected with our customers, around 2,500 customers across the metros and around tier one and tier two cities. We've broken this age segment into less than 30 years, 31 to 44 years of age group, 45 to 59 and 60 years and above. And in this survey event we have done, we have come up with a holiday readiness travel report, which is actually the future of the travel post COVID-19. And here we have found that 75% of the people are saying health and safety would be the prime importance. Okay, now when you say health and safety, obviously everyone today has a fear whether the hygiene part is being taken care of or not. So SOTC and Thomas Cook together have come up very recently with an assured program, which is actually a comprehensive program to safe travel in the COVID-19 era. We have tied up with the Apollo chain of hospitals at every touch point, customer journey, and every customer touch point. For example, this assured program defines a series of health and safety measures across every touch point, starting from the airport to the airline, moment you land in that destination, your local transport, hotels, your restaurants, and even the attractions. This also encompasses our employees as well as our supply chain and the franchises and customers. When I say about health and safety, now SOTC, we have enhanced our health and safety measures to the next level. And when I say next level, we have ensured that the highest level of compliance of global standards are met. We have chosen, handpicked and chosen our delivery partners to an extent that they all meet up to the criteria of the SOTC requirements. Well, Thomas Cook SOTC, we have our offices across the globe, and we are working together to ensure that all our health and safety protocols are being met. Even the tour managers who are actually on the road with the customers, who would be on the tour helping the clients, they have gone through a rigorous training program who will be able to attend to if the immediate first aid queries. And like I said, the touch point right from when a client comes to our office, starting from that touch point to pre-tour, on tour, post tour, everything is being adhered to. When it comes to food, now, yes, for the Indians, even if we give you the best of the tour and the food is not authentic or the food is not as per their requirements, then the entire tour would go for a toss. So So yes, food is a very important concern out here when it comes to health and safety guidelines. The reason being, we normally are used to buffet. You know, the food layout would be a buffet, but maybe the health authorities and the food and safety authorities of India or even abroad, depending on the policies of every country, they would not allow us to use the buffet system right now. We might have to use the preset menus, but what we have done is, we have in our panel our renowned chefs who are going and they all qualify the HACCP guideline. When I say HACCP, it's the Hazard Analysis Critical Control Point. That's the HACCP certified chefs. So they are all qualified, HACCP qualified chefs, and they can also be in touch with the local restaurants or the local caterers who can guide them how to do the authentic, because earlier, normally what we do in a big groups, we take our caterers from India. Currently, they might not be allowed. The local authorities from every country might not allow us to carry even the food which we take from India, in which case we will or we might have to think global and act local. In the sense, we might have to use the local ingredients and which is available there, which has been passed through by the local bodies, and then create curate the menus, which is as per the requirement and taste of our people. Also, we will not be allowed to use the buffet system, we are coming up with a new concept called singing chefs, you know, which is hot live stations everywhere, whichever areas, places that allow us to take our chefs. Obviously, it might take time for the people because they would be making the menus or the dishes in front of them live, and we're going to revive those lost recipes of India. And the chefs also will, why we're calling them singing chefs, because they would be connecting with the people. They would be taking them along the roots, the herbs, the benefits of those of that particular dish. And this is how we are planning to keep the people engaged and taking care of the safety and health guidelines in place.
Okay. You mentioned about touch points, and it seems that your preparations are quite robust in terms of ensuring that all touch points do not have the physical touch while the emotional touch is maintained.
True. In fact, it's not just us. The entire travel fraternity is all set to welcome guests. For example, if I talk about the Bangalore International Airport, they are starting with the minimum human interface so that there is no physical touch. So they're going to do their online check-ins. They're going to drop the boxes on the console themselves. They're going to do the print the boarding passes on their own. Similarly, Bombay International Airport have come up with their own SOPs. Like, they need to keep sanitizing the space at frequent intervals. It's a mandate that we all need to pass through the thermal screen. And there are also at frequent distances remind us of the social distancing. They have put queue managers in place. So these are the already the precautionary measures which are being taken by the by each and every segment of the travel industry. For again, Istanbul International Airport, they have made it a mandate. If a foreign national lands in their country, they need to have a personal insurance, personal health insurance, and they are also tested COVID-19 aboard the flight by health professionals. Turkey has also come up with a health certificate where it says that it covers all the measures, all the areas, again, which I mentioned, starting from the hotels, the transportation, whether it is sanitized or not, the attractions, even the employees, the health of the employees which are in the hotels. So all these global standards are being met by each and every touch point. The World Tourism and Travel Council have recently launched a hygiene and safety stamp, allowing the travelers to recognize businesses which abides by all these global standards. So yesterday I had a webinar with the Singapore Tourism Board. They have also come up with SG health place, which means, again, this, everyone is talking about each and every touch point. Moment the passenger lands in the country, from the, at the airport, then when they go by the transport system, and the attractions, hotels, restaurants, everything has been taken care of. So I think the passengers need that trust, that confidence, which is required at this point of time, and we are all there for them.
True. So by when do you think that people would start traveling? Traveling in general and traveling for leisure in particular?
Right. And I mentioned about the holiday readiness travel report, which we have done the survey. If Shanuka, if you can show that slide of the survey, it'll help. It's actually the future of the travel post-COVID-19. It reflects the key consumer behaviors and trends, if you see that. You know, 14% of the people are saying that travel is set to rebound. I mean, they are ready to go. They are already fed up with the confinement zone. The moment the restrictions are lifted, they are ready to travel. Whereas 45% of the people have said that they will travel only by 2021. But what we are looking at, we are focusing on our most potential segment, which is the 41%. They are saying that they have still not decided when they would travel. Look at the key travel drivers. 72% of the people are preferring to travel with reputed brands across their journey, be it the tour operators or the hotel chain. The reason being, we are the ones who have to give them the trust, the confidence that we are adhering to all the health and safety guidelines to ensure that they are safe at every point. I already touched about the 75% of the people have mentioned that health and safety is the primary concern. Now, domestic tourism with the Indian skies opening up have definitely taken a center stage. And 64% of the people are saying that they would go initially. I mean, July and August, the international skies will be opening up for international travel. But right now, 64% are willing to go domestic for the domestic holidays, which is why SOTC have come with this short gateway packages, weekend packages. So we have called it as back to life holidays, and we are taking care of the desired expectations of the customers' behavior and preferences. So we have come up with this local escapes and the self-driving experiences. We've also come up with this unique experiences, which can be created across the cities. Now, also, you can change the slide. Also in this holiday readiness report, it says that 63% of the people are willing to travel solo. Now, because of the social distancing, because people need to maintain their social distancing, 63% of the people, they said they would prefer to travel solo. When they say it solo, in the sense they would be going with their immediate families or extended families or with their friends and families. However, 25% all still feels that they are okay to travel with a group size of less than 20 people. And 12% said that they are okay if the group size is around 35 plus. So these are the target segments which we've seen. I mean, this is how the consumers are willing to travel. We've also gone one step ahead to figure out how much are they willing to spend. And we've seen that 67% of the people have said that they are willing to spend less than a lakh, and around 11% are saying up to 2 lakhs. And mind you, from this 11%, 35% have also said that they are willing to spend more than what they should spend earlier, because they want to ensure that this health, safety, all these guidelines are met. And obviously for that, they need to go to only those hotels or boutique hotels where we have exclusively tied up with. They also want to rejuvenate themselves, to go to a wellness resort. And that's good for us. And I'm most happy, and we are all motivated. Shanuka, maybe you can change the slide and show the other slide. This day before yesterday, which means people are already ready and set to travel. SOTC has closed family group of six from Varanasi to Goa for July. So this is actually a very good signal for us travel fraternity. So coming to the B2B segment, enlarge this. Coming to the B2B segment, we have connected with our key corporates, like I mentioned there, and there, 67% of the people are telling us that we should connect with them around August, September, and the rest of them are saying that maybe Q4. So, because when I say the corporate, this is for them a reward and recognition, or they're connecting with the people. Their business also have to up to their expectations. So, we are in touch with the clients. We have come up with new initiatives. We have come up with new ideas, we've come up with SOTC travel vouchers, which we're giving it to the corporates, and they are giving it to their dealer segments or to their partners. So this is the way I think initially the domestic travel would start, and eventually it will move to the international travel.
Good, that ma'am. These data look quite optimistic, and kudos to you all that you have put in that confidence back into the hearts of the travelers. Now, given the fact that corporates are going through tough time financially, and that majority of them are getting accustomed to the technologies like video conferencing and webinars like this, do you think the corporates would be spending the same amount on travel going forward?
The research which we have done, we have found that 37% of the corporates are saying that the spend would remain the same. And the most important is 14% of them have not yet decided whether their spend would go up, remain the same, or reduce. So this is the segment which we are again targeting. So did you ask about automation? Did I hear this is the technology?
Sorry, I didn't get.
Was that your question about the spend?
Yeah, my question was only this, that whether they're spending, the corporate would be spending a similar kind of amount, or will it go down given the fact that now people are getting accustomed to this new technologies like video conferencing, and so meetings can be held online rather than physically being there. So that might have some impact. I don't know whether. What is your take?
So the thing is, because of social distancing right now, I mean, if you would have asked me in the month of February, connecting with your partners, I mean, the corporate's employees, or keeping their stakeholders engaged through digital platform, people wouldn't have accepted it. But today, that is the new world. I mean, the new normal, which we have to accept it. And it's going very successfully, trust me. Most of the corporates right now, I mean, for the last 2 weeks, we have been only giving demos and giving presentations to our corporates, and we have got RFQs for a bigger platform to the extent of 40,000 people to do this virtual conferencing and events. I don't want to name the corporates. We have got inquiries for 16,000, for 2,000, 40,000. So this is a new welcome, because corporates needs to connect with their employees, be it their dealerships people, or be it with their partners, their stakeholders. So this digital platform is the only way right now in the social distancing era to keep connecting with them. Maybe Shanuka can show the small video which I've shared with you all. It was a demo which was done for our internal team, just to show how the world has changed. I don't think there is a sound.
Shanuka, I think sound is missing. If you are on the earphones, you'll have to remove your earphones. Regarding this technology question, ma'am, I just want to bring in one more perspective.
Sorry, this was technology. The problem is at times we can't control.
I know. There's some sound issue. But to put the question of technology in perspective, I want to draw an analogy. When Mr. Subhash Chandra, around 3 decades ago, when Mr. Subhash Chandra, the chairman of SL Group, was contemplating the upon idea that instead of depending on our customers visiting us all the way to our amusement parks to consume entertainment, can there be a way wherein we can deliver the entertainment to our customers at their doorstep? And they came up with the solution in the form of GTV, the first private TV channel. Now my question is, can there be something like this in the present context wherein we can deliver tourism to the consumer at his doorstep? For example, something like virtual reality.
Virtual tour.
Wherein the customer can experience the various tourist destinations of the world right from the comfort of his home. Will it be feasible? Can technology be an enabler in this? This was just one thought, but in general, I want to have your view as to what role do you think technology can play in travel and tourism industry post-COVID-19?
It's a very good question. In fact, we have already, the concept has already started. We've already started doing virtual tours. In fact, I mentioned to you that our hotel partners, our DMCs, when we say DMCs, are destination marketing companies, that's our business partners across the globe. And the tourism bodies. This is the medium through which they are doing the trainings today. I mean, sitting at home, I can see the Blue Mosque of Istanbul. I can see the Hippodrome. I mean, and the entire virtual tour of the entire mosque. All right. But yes, the actual experience which you go and see, you don't get it there. But you do. I mean, the concept has started. We do have virtual tours in place, but this is the only thing. When you go and see the place, the experience which you have, and what you're sitting at home, what you see, are two different things. So, if you have seen this, the video which we have shared of virtual events and conferencing, you could see. I mean, you get the entire experience of an event right from the senior management speaking. sitting at his home. He's addressing the entire team, his entire crowd in multiple cities across the globe. Here, the MC was based out of Bangalore. My colleagues were from different multiple cities, Bangalore, Delhi, Bombay, Pune. They were there together as a panelist. We can even do the live performers. One of the young girls which you saw was performing was actually from USA. So this is a platform where sitting at your respective location, we can connect with multiple cities across the globe and the feel of an arena. For example, the senior management is giving the awards, the recognition to your people. I mean, the employee is still happy that the managing director is there and acknowledging his efforts, right? So in that, I mean, till such time the social distancing is to be met, this would be the best way, the digital mode, the new world, the new way we need to move around to still keep engaging ourselves with our stakeholders, and we look forward to many more such events which we are doing currently. We've also come up with a mobile app just to minimize our human interface. For example, earlier we had to go physically meet up with the customers to take the documents from that person, from the passenger to do the visa and insurance processing, right? Today, you don't need to do that. You just have to upload documents in this mobile app. You get your live travel information. What is the status of your visa? Where you get your tickets out there. That's a good mode, a good platform for your even feedback sessions. So technology is the in thing. It's a virtual, in this virtual world. The schools have started online classes. You guys have started online classes. We have started online meetings, webinars. What we are doing today is nothing but the scope of technology has gone beyond.
Okay, there is one question from one of the participants, Dr. Sanjay Joshi, and that is related to this thing only, virtual tourism. He is asking that whether it is really going to be the norm of the day, and what about the revenue generation in that? That is what he is asking. He has also raised one more question about the key drivers post COVID-19 which will drive the tourism industry. These are the two questions which we have come up with in the chat box from Dr. Sanjay Joshi.
If you ask me about whether this would be the, if you ask me honestly as a tour operator, I wouldn't want to continue this for a lifetime, because yes, at the end of the day, the personal touch is required. And the people need to experience going, the happiness which you would feel, the experience which you would get actually by going to a particular destination, experiencing the food, the flora, the fauna, you would not get sitting at home. So my question to this is, it will be there till the social distancing norms are there. People who would want to still continue and have an experience of a particular destination can still view that. But I would still recommend that we, once the social distancing norms are lifted or it comes under control, the club flattens up, and we are taking all the measures when it comes to health and safety. So keeping all these things in place, gradually the clients, the people, the customers, fear would come out from their mind and they would start traveling. No one's going to stay within the four walls and, then we all need to rejuvenate. We all need to take a break now. So it's time to go on holidays. Back to life packages are back with SOPC. And I also did mention about the key travel drivers. The most important thing which the clients today are looking for is a very reputed brand, so that you can have full trust and confidence in these brands. When I say brands, it's starting from the tour operators, it's starting from the hotel chains. If I'm not using a standalone hotel properties, but an international chain, maybe an ITC, Hilton, Accor Group, the Marriott chain, all these are the hotels. All of them are adhering to the global standards of health and safety guidelines. Protocols are being met. The compliances are of high standards.
Okay. Is there any other questions? We are open to the participants, and just wait for a couple of minutes Are there any questions? Because the two questions which have come up so far, we have already been answered. And we have also received acknowledgement from Dr. Sanjay Joshi, thanking ma'am for the answer. Okay. So if there are no more questions, then I would simply say that we are on dot 40 minutes is generally the Zoom.
So the time management was good.
Yeah. There are few more questions, I'll just see. Are people in a mood to travel now? Is the next question.
Yes. I mentioned, we all need to applaud that just day before yesterday, we have done our first booking post COVID-19. A family of six from Varanasi, they are celebrating some family occasion in Goa for the month of July. So bookings have already started coming.
There is a question about how people will feel safe in terms of traveling.
So like I mentioned, keeping in mind all the safety requirements, that you need to wear your mask, you need to wear gloves, you need to maintain social distancing. I'll give you an example. In SOTC, for example, we have trained our tour managers, like I mentioned, to ensure that every day in the morning, they would be screening, they would be taking the temperatures of the people at every contact point. We have in all across the globe and across the country, and we have, like in India, we've already tied up with Apollo group of hotels, Apollo chain of hospitals. Similarly, across the globe, we have tied up with the medical fraternity, so that any emergencies are being addressed, are being adhered to. Food, which is most important, we are taking care of the measures which needs to be taken for the safety and hygiene purpose. Sanitization of the coaches. We have tied up only those supply chain who are following and adhering to SOTC protocols. So the sanitizations of the coaches, the drivers, the local guides, attractions, everything are being taken care of. So to answer your question and to give you more confidence to this, let me put it in this way. SOTC people are first going to that particular destination. When I'm saying initially in domestic, once it opens up, we are personally going to see, inspect that particular hotel, everything is as per our protocol or not, and then we are selling those properties. We are, which is why we have signed with only those boutique hotels which are known, like the Taj chain of hotels, the Hilton, the ITCs, which are renowned properties. The Hilton, the Marriott chain. No.
Great. There's one more question as to how do you see the future of tourism industry? I think it has mostly been answered, but still if you have anything to add, you can.
The future is bright, start traveling. We need to accept that we have to come out of the fear which we had, and this is the new normal. We have to live with it, and we have to ensure that we ourselves take care of the minimum requirement, which is wearing a mask, wearing gloves, not to touch our faces, the nose, ears, what our nose, mouth, and the eyes, which they've instructed, taking care of rest, whatever is to be taken care of from our end as a travel partner is being taken care of. So be rest assured, travel is going to start with a bang.
There is one more question as to, while following all these norms of enhanced safety and these protocols, will it not make the travel products costlier?
Yes and no. So, like I said, 35% of the people are willing to pay more than what they used to spend earlier, which is why we have done this survey. The survey has actually helped us, and which is why we've named it as, the Holiday Readiness Travel Report. And this is the future of this travel, this survey report is the future of the travel post-COVID-19. Because it reflects the key consumer behaviors and trends. Because they are, the customers are saying, we are willing to pay more than what we used to spend before, but we need to be taken care of properly. Our health, our safety is a primary concern.
Okay. There's another question. Is there going to be any change in the kind of destinations people would like to travel going forward?
Right. Current scenario, I'm talking about international. For example, immediately, yesterday we had a webinar with the Singapore Tourism Board people. I mean, in Singapore, there is still around 12,000 active cases. So obviously everything is governed by the local authorities. When are the boundaries going to be open? The restrictions are going to be lifted. Now, Vietnam, Cambodia, they hardly have 1 and 13 cases. Mauritius is another destination. So we have to see the connectivity. When are the airlines going to open up? When will the government of India give us approval to fly out of the country? So destination, we have a list of destinations where like Malaysia, Singapore, Thailand, the Southeast Asian countries have already opened up locally. The way we have opened up domestically, our domestic states, within our, we can keep traveling. Similarly, these countries have opened up locally, and most probably by July, most of them are going to open up. Singapore, we still do not know. But yes, Indian government has to give an approval for the for international travel, which is most likely to be by August, keeping our fingers crossed.
Okay. Any change in your marketing strategies or your advertisement campaigns or your message to encourage people to, you know, travel more? That is the next question.
Yeah, which is why I said we have come out with these launches, which is called the Back to Life Holiday Packages. So people today are wanting to travel, just want to get away from the city to maybe a quick local escape, you know, a short stay, weekend holidays, self-drive vacations. Or even in the city, they would want to just move out of, because enough of 3 months staying inside the house, they would want to go and stay in a nice wellness resort in the city and experience a nice spa. So we have tied up with all these hotel chains and wellness centers, boutique hotels, which is closer to the city. And we've also termed it as leisure. It's, you know, business come leisure. So the family man might be on a business trip and they're taking the family along with that. It's a pleasure trip.
There's another question, that if this international flights do not resume, will that be a blessing in disguise for untapped destinations of India, domestic travel?
Domestic is definitely going to, it is definitely going to help to grow this year. And trust me, I was also telling my colleagues that I regret for not personally focusing on selling domestic destinations, and my focus was only international. This 2.5 years of rigorous training of trying to, grading ourselves uplifting our knowledge skills. I mean, everything is there within our country. I mean, it's so beautiful. We have come up with innovative packages. We've come up with nice experience. I'm using the word again, wellness therapies, so that people can just go and rejuvenate and come back fresh. So yes, domestic tourism is going to definitely boost up this year. And I hope that it continues. In fact, just before this, prior to this session, I had an interactive session with IIM Shillong. Where they wanted me to participate in how can tourism in Northeast be developed? How can we boost tourism in Northeast? And I, coming from Northeast, it is a very it's a subject which is very close to my heart. So it was a very good session, and I look forward to actually being of a big help for them.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. It has been a really enlightening session for all of us. And on behalf of School of Business, Mori University, I would like to extend our sincere gratitude
to
you for sharing your experience and wisdom with us. And I would also like to thank all the participants for making this webinar so successful. So many questions have been pouring in.
And I would like to thank Shanuka
for all your efforts. Yeah, you have to say something.
I wanted to thank Shanuka for her coordination. She's really helped in the last couple of days. Yeah.
That's exactly what Shanuka and team has really put in great efforts to put everything together. And last but not the least, a big thank you to our Dean, Professor Anirban Sen Gupta for all the encouragement and support. So with this, we end this session here, and we can all sign off here. Thank you all.
Thank you so much. Bye.